When I was young, I was always taught living your life by the rules of Islam is the only way you'll ever truly be successful. Sharia law in this case, which is Islamic law derived from the Quran and the Sunnah, which are the practices of Muhammad, is the preferred way for many Muslims to live by, as they believe it's a fair and just system that will reward them not only in this world, but the one after.
But are countries really better off under Islam? I'm not personally religious, but I grew up in a Muslim country and heard plenty of people tell me that if they follow Allah, their country would be blessed and prosperous. Whether you believe in the existence of God or not, this is an easily testable claim. And today we'll be looking at 20 of the most Muslim and 20 of the most secular countries, according to a Gallup poll and a Pew Research survey. And then we'll compare them on 10 different measurements of success, development, and happiness to find out if countries really are better off under Islam, right after this intro. In 2009, Gallup polled thousands of people from 114 different countries asking them, is religion an important part of your daily life? And then they sorted these countries by religiosity. At the same time, Pew Research surveyed thousands of people and compiled a list of countries sorted by the percentage of their population that self-identified specifically as Muslim. So let's take these two lists and compare the top 20 most secular countries with the top 20 most Muslim ones. As some of the data we'll be analyzing can get a bit technical, so if you're not sure what these metrics measure or what any of this means, I really recommend that you start with part one of this series where I go a little more in depth and you'll be up to speed in less than 10 minutes. I'll put a link to that video below. First, we'll be looking at GDP per capita, a measurement of how much wealth a country produces per citizen of that country in a given year. According to data from the World Bank, the Muslim countries averaged $3,972 per person per year. That's not a lot to live on. The secular countries, by comparison, were over 7 times wealthier. And what's more, the secular countries were also slightly better about income distribution. For that, we'll look at the Gini Index, which is a measurement of income inequality ranging from 0 to 100, where 0 is 0% inequality and everyone makes the same amount, and 100 is 100% inequality, where one person has all of the wealth and everyone else has nothing. The Muslim countries ranked a whole 2.8 points worse than the secular ones. Not a huge difference, but still noticeable. There was, however, a noticeable gap when it came to corruption, where they ranked significantly higher, over twice as corrupt as their non-religious counterparts. Not only were the Muslim countries more corrupt, they were astronomically less free in terms of freedom of expression, with 16 of the 20 countries ranking as not free, 4 ranking as partially free, and 0 as free, according to Freedom House's Press Freedom Score. By comparison, the non-religious countries were an average of 37.95 points freer, with 15 countries ranking as free, 1 partially free, and only 4 not free. And not only was there less press censorship in secular countries, but more of the population was able to read, with almost 100% literacy rates. The countries adhering to Islam, by comparison, were an average of 29% less literate. And when you go country by country, in 8 of the Muslim countries, roughly half the adult population, or more, couldn't read. And this disproportionately affected women. The total fertility rates in Muslim countries was significantly higher, and the average woman had 2 more babies over the course of her life compared to women in secular countries.
The cure for poverty has a name, in fact. It's called the empowerment of women. If you give women some control over the rate at which they reproduce, if you give them some say, take them off the animal cycle of reproduction to which nature and some doctrine, religious doctrine, condemns them, and then if you're throwing a handful of seeds perhaps and some credit, the floor of everything in that village, not just poverty, but education, health and optimism will increase. It doesn't matter, try it in Bangladesh, try it in Bolivia. It works all the time. Name me one religion that stands for that, or ever has. Wherever you look in the world and you try to remove the shackles of ignorance and disease and stupidity from women, it is invariably the clerisy that stands in the way.
Because many of the Muslim countries in this list lacked the resources for advanced universally accessible medical care, their infant mortality rates also suffered and were over 6 times higher. For every 1,000 births, nearly 40 infants wouldn't live to see their first birthday, compared to only 6 deaths per 1,000 infants among the non-religious countries. And the overall average life expectancy in the Muslim countries was also lower, with an average of almost 9 years shorter lifespans. Now, in terms of violent crime, the Muslim countries really were about the same when comparing homicide rates, and ranked only marginally worse. Although I should point out that some of the data on homicide rates here, although it all came from the same source, the UN Human Development Reports, is massively underreported. While we're on the topic of violence, many apostates, especially women, leaving the Muslim faith, can face mental and physical abuse, including honor-based violence and honor killings.
So-called honor killings are denounced by all major religions, yet there are around 5,000 each year across the world, largely from South Asia, the Middle East, and North Africa.
For this reason, Zahra Kay, who you heard from at the beginning of this video, and her organization Faithless Hijabi are raising money for their mental health program, which partners with a clinic in the UK specialized in providing therapy for apostates. Depending on the session length, for as little as 20 to 40 pounds right now, you can change someone's life for the better and sponsor a remote online therapy session for an ex-Muslim or questioning Muslim.
Please support Faithless Hijabi's mental health program, where we help pay for their mental health sessions.
Now, because the Muslim countries ranked worse on every single metric we've explored, it's no surprise that the people in the non-religious countries were also measurably happier. When asked to rank their contentment with their lot in life on a hypothetical ladder where the top step, number 10, represents the best possible life that they can imagine, and the bottom step is the worst possible life, people from the Muslim countries put themselves an entire 1.34 steps on average lower than people in the non-religious countries. So not only were the citizens of the secular countries better off on every metric, they also viewed their lot in life more favorably. I'm going to link to all of this data and my sources in the description box of this video, and I encourage you to check it out. There are tons of other metrics that we could explore, and I highly recommend that you do so. If you're a content creator, feel free to use my data and visuals from this video. My one request is that you cite me as your source. Today, I released three videos, one comparing the most religious countries of all religions with the most secular ones to see if atheism leads to some kind of divine curse and unavoidable ruin. Then this video and the one on Christianity comparing the secular countries with countries following specific religions to see if each religion provided any kind of divine blessing or benefits. I pulled all of the data for each list from the same sources. I didn't cherry pick the data, and I applied the same methodology to each list fairly. No matter how I split the data, on a macro level, the secular countries outperformed the religious ones on every single metric. Does this mean that atheism leads to prosperity or that religion causes nationwide poverty and failure? Not necessarily. Correlation doesn't necessarily mean causation. But there is a strong correlation, and there are often elements of religion that could hold countries back. In addition to regressive stances towards women's rights, the suppression of free expression, and the obsession with dogmatic devotion to a single book, religious adherents often chase after divine distractions as solutions to problems where earthly ambition and efforts are required. For example, when Egypt's president Nasser asked the head of the Muslim Brotherhood what his number one desire was for Egypt, the answer wasn't some elaborate plan to raise people out of poverty, improve trade relations, or improve schools. It was to force women to all wear veils. And there's one thing that this data does prove beyond a shadow of a doubt, and that's that you don't need religion for societies to thrive and prosper. They do it just fine without religious distraction slowing society down. This series of videos has taken me a month and a half to produce, so I really appreciate everyone for your patience, and especially appreciate my patrons, supporters on Subscribestar, and PayPal donors for believing in me. Thank you. Also, don't forget to check out Zahra's fundraiser to provide therapy to women facing abuse for leaving the Muslim faith. I'll put a link to that below as well. Thank you, everyone, and as always, dare to be curious, but don't drink the Kool-Aid.